Here we're going to simply summarize the full catabolic pathways utilized to generate ATP from carbohydrates, from fats, and from amino acids derived from proteins. If we start with our carbohydrates, here we have some glucose being delivered from the bloodstream. Occasionally, as in muscle, it's stored within the cells as glycogen. But it's going to be processed through the metabolic pathways of glycolysis that convert glucose to pyruvate. We do get a little bit of ATP production along that pathway. That's only important when we are very hypoxic, low on oxygen, because this is an anaerobic pathway. It does not require oxygen. Or when cells need ATP very, very quickly. In a good example there would be very active skeletal muscle. And that's because glycolysis can produce more ATP per unit time than the aerobic pathways down here in the mitochondria, which seemed counterintuitive, but it's a less complex pathway. It's very inefficient, but can make ATP very quickly. And so that will dominate as the primary source of ATP only, again, when we're hypoxic, as some tissues are, like connective tissue cells that don't have a good blood supply, or again, when ATP demand is very high. One other possibility for relying largely or entirely on glycolysis is in cells that lack mitochondria, such as red blood cells. They don't have the options of running the Krebs cycle and electron transport chain, so they're stuck with glycolysis alone. The output of pyruvate is taken up by the mitochondrion. It's converted into acetyl groups, which then can enter the Krebs cycle. We've seen this before, where our hydrogen atoms are released and can supply the electron transport chain for a very dramatic increase in the production of ATP. Fatty acids can also be utilized by many cell types. They are processed through beta oxidation. We're cleaving two carbon groups off of those fatty acid chains to produce acetyl groups. Again, repeating this cycle of entering the Krebs cycle and then supplying the electron transport chain. And then finally, we have amino acids derived from proteins, which can be deaminated. We have to get the amino group off of there because the nitrogen has no place in these pathways. And that amino group is released by the cells and then converted to urea at the liver, a waste product. The product left over is a keto acid, which can, because there are a whole variety of amino acid structures, there are a whole variety of keto acid structures, and they can therefore enter the Krebs cycle at a variety of locations based upon their structure. Again, adding carbon groups to the Krebs cycle, producing more ATP, releasing more hydrogen atoms, and again, fueling the electron transport chain for what we've said again is this major production of ATP over here. Again, key things to point out are is that glycolysis is anaerobic. It does not require oxygen. And processes only carbohydrates, of course, whereas the mitochondrion processes all three nutrient types, but is oxygen requiring. And what that would mean, therefore, is that the utilization of fats for ATP production or the utilization of amino acids for ATP production is only aerobic.